إن الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل، فقد أمرنا الله تعالى بذلك في كتابه الكريم، فقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال تعالى: يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. ثم أما بعد. Dear brothers and sisters, when Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi, the person who murdered Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he planned his scheme or decided that he was going to murder Umar, he decided to choose the time, the best time, where the people's concentration would be focused away. And he decided to choose the time of Salah. And the Salah where the people's concentration would be the strongest was in the Fajr and when it was dark, and so he chose that time. Abu Lu'lu' in the Masjid al-Nabawi, he had chosen a pillar to the side of the mihrab, the place where the Imam prays, where Umar radiallahu anhu was coming, the Khalifa of the Muslimin was coming for Fajr prayer to lead the congregation. And he stayed there all night, waiting in the darkness. And he had to stay there during the night because the people would then fill in the first row, the second row, and fill in the rows from there. As Umar radiallahu anhu would recite, and it's narrated that Umar radiallahu anhu would choose long surahs in the Fajr prayer so that the people and the Muslims of Medina could come and be able to join in the salah. So he would read very long surahs in the first rak'ah. And as the salah started, Umar radiallahu anhu began to recite, Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi came out from the corner. And they say also that the fact that someone was walking in front of them wasn't something strange for them, because very often the masjid would fill up and people would have to go by the imam and pray beside the imam. Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi went to Umar radiallahu anhu with a dagger that was poisoned, stood right in front of Umar radiallahu anhu and slit open his stomach during the salah. Now there's some very important points that happen after that. Umar radiallahu anhu screamed from the pain, but notice, and the narrations that we remember that Umar radiallahu anhu is the person that died, but actually seven Sahaba died in that same incident, because when he turned around, the front row was so packed together that there was no way he could escape except through the Muslims. And so he began stabbing left and right, killing another a Muslim after a Muslim as he tried to make his way out until they had thrown a cloth over him. Umar radiallahu anhu didn't shut down the salah. He didn't stop the salah. He continued leading the prayer. And as some people may say that bleeding breaks your wudu, we have here the example of Umar radiallahu anhu, who was bleeding profusely but continued his salah and continued to pray. Some people thought that he had made a mistake in his recitation, but he hadn't. He had completed his salah. And by that time, Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi, someone had thrown a cloth over him, and that knowing that he was captured, he took the same dagger and killed himself and committed suicide. And Umar radiallahu anhu later passed away after that because of those wounds. The importance of salah cannot be overstated in Islam. If you see the ahadith talking about the pillars of Islam, the things by which Islam stands, and by which if they're broken, the Islam collapses on that person. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَىٰ خَمْسِ شَهَادَةِ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ that there's no God but Allah, وَأَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ and that I'm the messenger of Allah, وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِقَامَةُ الصَّلَاةِ to establish the salah, coming immediately after the tawheed of a person. And you'll see that in the most majestic circumstances does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speak about the salah. For when all the ahkam, all the rulings were revealed on earth to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah chose the Isra, chose the Mi'raj, the ascension of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the heavens when he came closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and at that point Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the salah fard and compulsory upon the Muslims. And read in the Quran in Surah Taha when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to Musa alayhi salam and speaks directly to Musa. And these are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Musa.
وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدْنِي وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Musa that there is no God but me. And Allah, these are the words that Allah said to Musa. فَاعْبُدْنِي, so worship me. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي, and establish the prayer for my remembrance. And you'll see that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the believers, such as in Surah Mu'minun, you'll see consistently that one of the greatest characteristics of the believers, because you see many groups, people trying to increase the iman of their followers, and many workers, people, Muslim activists, working to increase the iman of their people, look at the mu'min and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them.
قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ,
that the believers are successful, the mu'minun. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't just leave you there, that you go and figure out what a mu'min is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then describes the characteristics one after the other.
الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ,
those who concentrate in their salah. Those in their salah, those who concentrate. And you'll notice here that it's not a question whether they do salah or not. To be a mu'min, the person has to do their salah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says one step more than that, it is those that concentrate in their salah. And the importance of the salah comes in hadith after hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَوَّلُ مَا يُسْأَلُ الْعَبْدُ عَنْهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ الصَّلَاةِ, the first question that the person will be asked on the Day of Judgment is the salah. And subhanAllah, some people, maybe in the university, you try to get a cheat sheet, or if there's the day before the exam, if you could get the questions that are going to be asked, you would go and prepare for that. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you the question that's going to be asked. And you know the question, and you know you're going to be tested. Allah subhanahu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the first question, question number one, you pull down the paper and it says question number one, how was your salah? فَإِنْ كَانَ خَيْرًا, that if it's good, then everything after that should good. You should pass your complete exam on the Day of Judgment. And if it's bad, then everything after that should be bad. And in reality, when a person has the khushu' and increases his awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the salah, when they leave the salah, as some of the ulama of the past have said, that they'll enter salah and they feel sadness that the salah is going to come to end soon. Whereas when a person hasn't reached that level, they're concerned that the salah, hoping that the salah will end soon. But these are people who have understood the salah, having the sadness in their heart that they're in the third rak'ah, the fourth, and their connection and their discussion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and their prayer to Allah is going to complete. And so when the person comes to that lofty position of his nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the salah, after he completes the salah, he feels ashamed and shy to go back to the low position that he may have done, the sin that he may have done before that salah. And that's the kind of spirit that the salah increases in a person as they go from fajr to dhuhr, to al-asr, to al-maghrib, to al-isha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ, that verily the salah forbids a person from the fahsha and the munkar. But you'll see in our community of musalleen, and this is something that remains with the community, that so long, that there are so many bid'ah that may come in, but the one thing that remains consistent is the salah amongst the Muslims. And if you go to other religions and you see that the way they worship, you go from one church to the next and you'll never find two people worshiping in the same way, or two churches worshiping the same way. But when you see the Muslims, you can go from here to any country in the world and people will be performing the salah. But in that community of musalleen,
you have some hazy actions that need to be corrected. For example, some of us don't concentrate on what we're saying during the salah. Some speed when they pray. Some wander with their gaze during the salah. The number of raka'at, you'll see by the third raka'ah that many of the people in the jama'ah don't know if it's the third raka'ah or the fourth. And for some, the dunya hugs their heart. They may concentrate more on their groceries than what they're saying in the salah. And sometimes before the imam even says Allahu Akbar, the person's already speeding into that next position, beating the imam. And if you compare this to those who came before us, Rabi' ibn Khaytham, rahimahullah ta'ala, they said from his consistent lowering of his gaze in salah and outside of salah, people used to think he was blind. People used to think he was blind. He was a student of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. And when he would walk with Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, or he would come, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud's servant would say to him,